or progressive Congress commends government's approach to war against corruption.
The issue of whether somebody is PDP or not PDP does not arise. We have a nation to cleanse. The president has committed himself to that.
Federal government says outbreak of Lassa fever in some states now under control.
Senate President urges Senate to work towards speedy consideration of priority bills and the actualization of the Buhari change agenda.
We must demonstrate that a strengthened democracy can be used for the betterment of everyone. People must see and feel the impact of the laws we pass in their communities, on the streets, and in their pockets.
Enhancing food sufficiency in a rural agricultural sector through applied research is our focus today on Good Morning Nigeria.
Yes, talking about food, there is a place to grow them. At present, Nigeria has over 80% arable land, most suitable for the cultivation of diverse food and cash crops. Unfortunately, less than 40% is being cultivated, that is out of the land, despite the country's large population and high level of unemployment.
Well, let's go over again to that very well-known fact that up until the 1960s, the agricultural sector in Nigeria was the most important in terms of contributions to domestic production, employment, and foreign exchange earnings. Now, the story changed with the emphasis being placed on crude oil exports, and particularly also in the early 1970s following the Arab-Israeli war, when crude oil prices spiked after 1973. Now, in the intervening years, a number of measures have been introduced by various governments, but nothing much would appear to have changed in terms of the fortunes of our agricultural sector.
Well, you're right, Kingsley. Agriculture, no doubt, has become the most important subsector, of course, after petroleum, which you rightly emphasized. But then the need to place greater emphasis on agriculture, however, remains compelling. This stems from the fact that the sector employs over 75% of the population, the ever-growing demand for food and raw materials. And more importantly, the sector contributes about 44% to the country's gross domestic product. Of course, you know that it has its own way of making its move to other subsectors.
That's right. It has a knock-on effect. There's no doubt.
No doubt.
I agree with you, Blessing. That's precisely part of the reason why we are focusing on it today. Now, a number of authors have attributed a decline in Nigeria's agricultural production to also the neglect of agricultural research, which is regarded as very crucial in agricultural revolution. This, of course, has been the experience in a number of developed and developing economies in the world. Now, at present, Nigeria has, as it were, the largest and most elaborate national agricultural research systems in sub-Saharan Africa.
Well, quite right, Kingsley. By 2006, the government actually had set up an umbrella body known as the Agricultural Research Council of Niger. But before then, there had been other interventions of agricultural development projects or programs, at least towards the end of the Civil War. There were means to actually say that, okay, each of the region or those days that or the states actually had different development programs, and these were actually to actually look into the aspect of food security.
That's
and
right.
To be sure that okay, everyone was actually looking well, considering the issue that happened in war that time. Okay, ARCN, which of course was established to address the challenges faced by the agricultural research system, its mission is to achieve a significant improvement in agricultural productivity, marketing, and also the competitiveness through generation of appropriate technologies, policy options, and also knowledge management of the two agricultural research systems. Well, agricultural research providers provides information for policymakers and also to fund agencies. It will also take on the aspect of transferring of research-induced technology to farmers, which is the only way to measure research benefit to the society. These are so many things that have been interventions from time to time.
Well, I think, person, part of what we need to say this morning is, look, what is the purpose of agricultural research? Agricultural research, you know, covers a wide range of activities and issues pertaining to agriculture. It may have to do with the soil. You know, what is the best soil to cultivate? Which of the best crops to grow in a particular soil?
And kind of improved seedlings or seeds.
You're talking about improved seedlings. Mm-hmm. You know, where crop disease resistant. Crops and any varieties that, of course, can grow. In the past, you would say that, okay, you can cultivate two or three crops, say, per year, you know, in a particular farming season, rather than cultivating just one crop and then waiting. So which varieties develop, grow, and then you can harvest much more readily. In other words, how do you boost your agricultural output through the application of research? And that's what we're focusing on again this morning, that we have a number of research institutes. They've also come up with a number of studies, even though they have their own challenges, namely
but
poor funding.
Much of this study actually impact on the farmers who ultimately will be the ones who grow some of this.
That's right. And that's where, again, we'll be talking about extension services. So these are the issues that, of course, we'll be taking a look at on the program this morning. My name is Kingsley Osadolo, and I welcome you to this edition of Good Morning Nigeria. And as usual, we're live on the network service of the Nigerian Television Authority.
And my name is Blessing Abu. I join Kingsley in welcoming you to today's edition, which promises to be very fruitful and actually enterprising, because we'll be taking a look at some of the things that will help us sustain our food security, definitely. Also, on the program, we'll be taking a look at our companion segments, which will, of course, dwell on sports, entertainment, art and entertainment, and also tidbits from the foreign scene. Well, it's time now to join Rhoda. I know she's never been a farmer, but I'm sure she'll benefit a lot because there are intervention funds from time to time. Who knows? One of such will be coming to you.
All right, thank you, Bless. Never being a farmer, but of course, with the way that we're going, agriculture is, of course, the next thing, big thing that Nigeria should be looking at the way the oil price is actually dwindling right now. Good morning, Nigeria, and thank you for joining us. The governing All Progressives Congress, APC, says it has no regret or apology whatsoever regarding the way and manner the fight against corruption has been prosecuted by the Buhari administration. National chairman of the party, John Odigi Oyegun, stated this while speaking to newsmen after a meeting between President Muhammadu Buhari and the National Working Committee of the APC.
We're fulfilled, happy that the government has substantially plugged the leakages in the system. There is still a lot to be done, and we are looking forward to the early passage of the budget so that full implementation will begin. The APC has not been in office at the national level for the last 10, 16 years. So the issue of whether somebody is PDP or not PDP does not arise. We have a nation to cleanse. The president has committed himself to that. It has nothing to do with witch hunting. The APC is not in any way apologetic.
Vice President Yemi Osinbajo says the federal government is committed to the provision of houses to Nigerians as part of the change agenda of the present administration. Professor Osinbajo stated this at the foundation laying of a 2,000 units in Kaduna. Sorry for the loss of audio in that report. Work towards speedy consideration of priority bills and the actualization of the Buhari administration's change agenda was what the Senate President Abubakar Bukola Saraki's charged to senators as the legislators commenced plenary in 2016. National Assembly correspondent Abdullahi Garba Benunkudu reports that senators also urged the Minister of Health and other relevant agencies to urgently find solution to the spreading Lassa fever epidemic.
Rule of law, equitable and transparent governance with nutritive nutrients and fairness. We must demonstrate that a strengthened democracy can be used for the betterment of everyone. People must see and feel the impact of the laws we pass in their communities, on the streets, and in their pockets.
Similarly, after resumption from its Christmas and New Year recess, the House of Representatives has passed for second reading a bill for an act to amend the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, EFCC Act 2004. This is aimed at strengthening the anti-graft agency and its effort towards fighting corruption. Also passed at second reading is a bill for an act to amend the National Agricultural Land Development Authority, NALDA, Act 2004.
Like the MBA,
we must not generally bring a professional. They could also get consultant.
We turn our attention now to health, as Lassa fever has spread to Ondo State, claiming two lives in its wake. The state health commissioner, Dr. Dayo Adeyanju, confirmed the development even as stakeholders strategize on ways to curtail the spread of the disease in the state. But the disease appears to be under control in Niger State, which is the worst heat state amongst the affected states. The State Commissioner for Health and Health Services, Dr. Mustafa Jibri, stated this when he gave an update on the status of the state concerning the outbreak in Mina. In the meantime, the federal government has assured Nigerians that the outbreak of Lassa fever in some states in the country is under control. The Minister of Health, Professor Isaac Adewale, and that of Information and Culture, Lai Mohammed, gave the assurance at a media briefing in Abuja.
We do not need to restrict travel to any part of the country. This disease is different from Ebola, and we need to tackle it differently from Ebola. I also want to assure us that this outbreak is under control and we do not need to panic.
I will seize the opportunity to further appeal to the media to continue to report on this outbreak with a view to keeping Nigerians adequately informed about the preemptive measures the government is taking. Also, it is important for the media to naturally align with the nation's interest whenever there's any threat to our lives or the sovereignty of our nation.
Now, the inaugural meeting of APAR sector participants by the Minister of Power, Works and Housing has agreed to take advantage of allowances by the Nigerian Television Authority, NTA, and other media outlets on public enlightenment around tariff and other issues in the electricity market. And lastly, on the news, the expertise of the Nigerian Army Engineering Corps is required to fix infrastructure in Niger State. This came to limelight during Governor Abubakar Sani's bailiff's courtesy call on the Chief of Army Staff, Lieutenant General Tukur Burate, at the Army Headquarters, Abuja. Defense correspondent Mohammed Abdul Kadri reports that the Minister of Sports, Solomon Dalong, and the Permanent Secretary, Ministry of Defense, Ambassador Danjuma, also visited Army and Naval Headquarters on courtesy calls.
And at least we're guaranteed of the quality. In a lot of areas, due to heavy downpour of rain, the rivers have washed away the bridges and culverts.
Let me assure you that in terms of security, our officers and men in your state will be up and doing.
And that's the news bit. It's back to Blessing and Kingsley for the continuation of Good Morning Nigeria. Good morning, Nigeria.
Many thanks, Rhoda. Thank you very much for the news. And this is Good Morning Nigeria. We'll take our first break to bring you some messages, and it will be time for business.
Nigerians, our fearless officers and men of the Nigerian military are winning the war against Boko Haram. Today, all occupied territories have been recovered and Boko Haram has been degraded. Our affected brothers and sisters are getting their lives back. However, they are now after you and me. In our mosques, churches, schools, motor parks, markets, entertainment centers, and public gatherings. Be vigilant. Be security conscious. Report suspicious persons, objects, and movements to the police and other security agencies. The security of our nation is a duty for you and me. Nigeria, unite against terrorism. This message is brought to you by the Federal Ministry of Information and Culture.
Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are.
Hey guys, so I've recently become a mommy and it is the greatest feeling in the world, but whew, also pretty daunting too. I'm sure you new moms can relate to my experience. Choosing the right diaper, there's so many brands out there. I used Pampers in the UK when I had Jamil and it was great. But some of my friends told me that Nigerian Pampers weren't as good, so we decided to try it for ourselves. Who slept so well? Who's a dry baby? Nigerian Pampers gets the thumbs up from me and the thumbs up from baby Jamil. He stays dry, he sleeps well, and you can see how much happy energy he has in the morning. I recommend Pampers to all of my friends. Don't take my word for it. Try it yourself and share your experiences.
Hello Nigerians, I am Chief Eric with Mafia, Trading Bank Erisco Foods Limited. As a partner manufacturer, Erisco Foods produces quality made in Nigeria product for every feeding for all Nigerians. Our sons and daughters can have better jobs and our economy can become bigger and stronger. Every time you buy imported products, you are importing unemployment, terrorism, kidnapping, crime and poverty into Nigeria. Please let us shine our eyes. Buy your products. Buy made in Nigeria because only Nigerians can make Nigeria great. Always buy made in Nigerian products like Ijiko, tomato paste, seasoning cubes and other made in Nigerian products. Support us to produce more products, create more employment and grow our economy. As Nigerian manufacturers, we cannot afford to joke with your well-being. Do the smart thing and support government policies to make our economy great for all of us.
With Jigo tomato paste, seasoning cubes and other great products are proudly made in Nigeria by Erisco Foods Limited.
All right, now on to our business segment. Bureau de Change operators are reacting to the central bank's stoppage of forex sales to the operators, just as stakeholders are also calling for dialogue between the Apex Regulatory Authority and the dealers. Details of this now with Seun Ogunleye.
All right, good morning. It's another time to look into developments in the world of business. Bureau de Change operators in Nigeria have been reacting to the Central Bank of Nigeria, CBN's, action to stop selling foreign currency to them. This, the operators believe, will further pressurize the Naira as it will create more paucity of funds at the parallel segment of the market.
A lot of stakeholders feel jittery, and that's exactly what is happening today. You cannot get foreign exchange to buy. It is true. Some people have it. Even they are kept keeping it. But if you mean that we are aware and we are able to reach our members, this will not happen. And the policy will still continue.
The acting chairman, North Central, of the association, Mr. Mahmoud Shehu, believes dialogue between the Apex Bank and the Bureau de Change Operators Association will help address the imminent challenges that the Apex Bank decision may pose on their businesses.
So you see, what we are saying is that for the policymaker, it's not every time they come on air to say this is this. No. You can use the stakeholder. This is what I want from you. And definitely it will be done. There's no two ways about it. It's either you comply or you go.
Anyway, Nigerians are very hopeful that this will help to stimulate the economy and also strengthen the Naira. Meanwhile, the Central Bank of Nigeria Governor Godwin Emefiele had also announced the Apex Bank decision to relax restriction on deposits on domiciliary accounts. These, he explained, will help increase availability of liquidity in the banking system.
What to do at that time is like a torrent, a flood of water. So you need to think about how to put a brake to that flood. That has, I would say, sort of been achieved. And at this point, we're beginning to think, let's open the tap a little and let's begin to see whether there will be proper, orderly behavior by operators as well as people in the market.
Finally, on the business package this morning, the Debt Management Office said Nigeria will sell 80 billion naira worth of bonds denominated in the local currency at an auction on January 20. Its first debt auction of the year. The Debt Management Office said it will issue 40 billion naira each of bonds maturing in 2020 and 2026 using the Dutch auction system. The 2020 debt is a reopening of a previously issued bond. Results of the auction are expected the next day. Nigeria has proposed a plan to issue 260 billion naira to 390 billion naira in 5, 10 and 20 year naira bond in the first quarter of the year. And that's the package on the business news for now. It's nice talking business with you. Good morning, Nigeria.
Good doing business with you too, Shane Ogunleye. Now it's time for a newspaper review on our lineup on Good Morning Nigeria.
Bayo Atoyebi is right here with us for this morning's edition of Newspaper Review. Bayo, it's our pleasure to have you as well.
Thank you, Kinsley. Good morning, Nigeria.
Okay, there are a number of stories that are trending on the front pages of the papers. We have issues on the budget 2016, Lassa fever, MTA and federal government and others.
Definitely.
Listen.
Of course, we also have the issue of the budget as well as PDP's Metu in custody. I think you talk about the Lassa fever.
That's
okay,
right.
I'll start off with The Guardian this morning. Senate in rowdy session over missing 2016 budget. With riders, Saraki summoned to Aso Villa. Presidency denies withdrawal of fiscal document as National Assembly may amend constitution over budgeting system. And still on the budget, the Daily Sun reported differently. 2016 budget missing. Well, not quite different, really. No trace of document in Senate. We have it. This is coming from Reps. Proposals not withdrawn is coming from presidency as Buhari and Saraki get in a closed door meeting. All the details you find on page 6 of the Daily Sun. And on the budget, still on the new front page of the New Telegraph, we have confusion as 2016 budget disappears from Senate. With riders, Saraki meets Buhari, keeps mum, as nobody can withdraw budget, says presidency.
Well, let me just read the allied headlines from the other papers with regard to the budget.
Budget, okay.
Nigerian pilot, that's the lead story, says 2016 budget withdrawn, not missing, and this is according to the paper's investigation. And it has two riders to that. Presidency reworks estimates, and Saraki, as the Senate President in Villa, keeps sealed lips. Details of this can be found on page 4. And now for This Day newspaper. This Day newspaper is the second lead story on the front page, just next to the photograph there. This Day newspaper says, again, Presidency and Udo Udoma deny withdrawing budget from National Assembly. And Saraki meets Buhari, keeps mom on appropriation bill. That's the story, that's the headline there for This Day. And of course, you also have it on the front page of the National Mirror, above the name flag of National Mirror. National Mirror says, confusion over missing 2016 budget. We are not aware, according to Saraki, I have not withdrawn it, that's Buhari. So, Bayo, what is the situation in terms of the details of the story?
The picture is quite confusing.
Yes.
Some newspapers are reporting that the Senate leader, Ali Ndume, had indicated in executive session that the budget was not available. And this raised concerns. But another senator who speaks on behalf of the Senate says that the budget is not missing. It is rumor and it is laughable. This is attributed to Senator Abdullahi Sahabi. In fact, on the other side of the aisle, in the House of Rep, Honorable Jonathan Gbefwe has indicated, in fact, copies are to be distributed to members today. So based on that, there was this speculation. And there was a visit by the Senate President to the Mr. President yesterday. And reporters were eager to ask about the true position of the things. And the spokesman for the President says that nobody except the President can withdraw the budget. And as far as we know, he has not done that. But the true position now is that two members, one from the Senate and one from the House of Reps, says that they are making copies for the 109 members and 360 members of the House of Representatives. And it may also be recalled that when the Senate resumed yesterday, the Senate President at the opening ceremony said the Senate has agenda remains to work with the executive to find solutions to economic stagnation, wastefulness, discrimination, empowerment, unemployment, insecurity, corruption and impunity. And they will do all they can to give the budget the attention it deserves. So between these conflicting facts, I think our viewers are left to make their own deductions. We have placed all the facts before them as it's coming from the sources.
That's right. No, but I hope it doesn't become, you know, what happened to the PIB. If you recall, at some point, that's the petroleum industry bill. There were said to have been three or four or five versions yes. that were floating around. But it certainly, this is not a document that is, it's not a flimsy document. It's not a one-pager. It's a document of several pages, and the presidency has explained that several copies were, of course, sent to the National Assembly following the president's presentation.
In fact, the anxieties about the budget is the concern that the oil price in the world market have dropped far below the $38 budget. And in fact, the Honorable Minister for Finance had an occasion to explain that when the MDAs come to defend their budget before the Senate and the House of Reps, if there's any need to review it downwards, it could be done there. So,
Minister of Finance was our guest on Good Morning Nigeria yesterday. All right, let's take other headlines.
About oil.
Oh, yeah, that's
I think
right.
We'll start off with that since Bayo took a cue from there. Nigeria in more pains as oil falls to $27.07 a barrel. This is found on the front page of The Guardian. With OPEC members' more emergency meeting. Naira slides to 300 Naira per dollar at parallel markets.
Well, still on oil, the lead story for this day newspaper says Kachiku is the Minister of State Petroleum and also Group Managing Director of NNPC. NNPC to hold first IPO by 2018. That's the initial public offering by 2018. Of course, that means that they would have gone through all the processes of restructuring the outfit. And then two other riders to that headline says that Kachiku says some OPEC members have called for an emergency meeting and UAE moves to quash talk of meeting as oil falls below $30 per barrel. Another economic copy, of course, is from this day above its name flag. It says customers besiege banks to deposit dollars. This is, of course, coming on the heels of the revision of the policy that earlier prevented commercial banks, from accepting dollars.
And still on banks, matter before Bayo comes in, just above the, I said for New Telegraph, reps to Central Bank of Nigeria, banks must refund COT charges. And then the writer says Dogara 6 review of foreign exchange policy.
Okay.
Well, talking about the headline from Guardian, actually, Guardian says that the oil price has fallen to its 7-year low. And it says that the website of OPEC is indicating that a basket price for oil has fallen as low as $27.07. And therefore, OPEC is considering holding an emergency meeting. Well, what is curious about this emergency meeting is that it's not likely to hold until next month, February, or maybe early March. Yeah. But meanwhile, the impact here domestically is that, particularly also going with the policy on Bureau de Change, Guardian also has reported that while the official rate remains 198, in Lagos it has gone to about 289, and in Kano already about 300. But this is the immediate reaction to the policy on the central bank. But naturally, it is expected that it will stabilize after a while. Meanwhile, the concern about the current oil price is affecting not only Nigeria, but all over the world, because the report also indicates that the production cost for Nigeria is about $30, Brazil $49, Canada $41, United Kingdom $52.5, United States $36. It is only Saudi that has a production cost of about $10, and Iraq about $10.7. So for most nations, at this rate, it is very uneconomical.
Even Saudi Arabia has introduced a number of policy measures, including the withdrawal of subsidies and some social services. So yes. that's what low oil prices
are doing to countries
around the world. Now let's take another headline, this time on MTN. That's for the front page of this day newspaper, just close to the foot of the front page of this day newspaper. Court rejects federal government's application to freeze MTN's account. Details of that can be found on page 6. Now, it's also a front pager for the Nigerian Pilot. The Nigerian Pilot says below the photograph on the front page there, says 1.04 trillion naira fine, powerful forces behind MTN's non-compliance, and court refuses freezing telecoms firm's accounts. Then, it's also a front pager for the National Mirror above the name flag. 1.04 trillion naira fine, that's the kicker. Court bars MTN from moving money out of Nigeria. Details to be found on page 6.
But it's making its own entrance, that's on the inside page of The Guardian, that's the MTN story. Court declines to bar MTN from emptying bank accounts. With Ryder, hearing on suit against fine begins January 22nd.
Yes, well, you recall that the MTN has been is to pay a fine based on a violation of the rules guiding its establishment, particularly with registration of subscribers. And as a fear of MTN emptying its account in Nigeria, the Office of the Attorney General, I think, had gone to court seeking to freeze 21 accounts that MTN has in various commercial banks. And they cite their reasons. They say, In February of 2008, MTN withdrew 936 million and sent it to accounts in Mauritius, Cayman Island, and British Virgin. They say, in fact, between October 2007 and 2009, MTN withdrew $7.7 billion out of Nigeria. And therefore, they fear that there is a deliberate attempt to empty the accounts of the telecom company so as not to comply with the fine. Judge said, well, they have not shown enough facts to wit that there is an attempt by the agency to do that. In the meantime, the court has enjoined all parties to remain in the with the status quo ante, which means that don't tamper with the account, don't do any other thing until the court determines.
All right, so Bayo, let's take another headline, this time from the Nigerian Pilot at the foot of the front page. They have a window on some stories that they have inside. Arms misuse, that's Nigerian Pilot. Inspector General of Police orders psychiatric test on personnel. That's coming from the Nigerian Pilot at the foot of the front page. And then on Lassa fever, just below the name flag of Nigerian Pilot, Lassa fever, deaths rise to 41 and Senate summons Health Minister. That's also on the front page of this day newspaper. FGE marks 140 million to fight Lassa fever. Death toll hits 41. Details of that can be found on page 10.
Well, same story also is trending on the front page of the New Telegraph. Policemen to undergo psychiatric tests. This is coming from the Inspector General of Police, but the details you find on page 2 of the New Telegraph. And still on the Lassa fever, we have Lassa fever death toll rises to 41. Of course, you find the story on page 5 of the New Telegraph. But The Guardian reported this way, high alert on Lassa fever as government confirms 41 death. Lagos monitors about 10 persons, 3 have tested negative, of course. Niger, Kano, Bauchi, worst affected. Senate summons the health minister to actually take a look at that. All right.
Well, on Lassa fever, from all indications, the death toll is 41. And from the report from the Honorable Minister of Health that as at yesterday, for the period of 3 days, there have not been any reported cases or any reported death. That is a positive indication that probably it is being contained. And Nigerians are enjoined to adopt very high hygienic practices, particularly those also who have see a delicacy in eating rats should be extra careful. Especially too, that Lassa fever, it broke in 1950. And it could not be identified until 1969 when it occurred and the victims were two missionary nurses in a Lassa, a village in Borno State. And that is why it has the name Lassa.
Lassa fever.
When it was eventually identified as a hemorrhagic fever and it got that name. For now, unfortunately, in Lagos, there have been reports of two deaths, three deaths in Lagos and two deaths in Ondo.
Yeah, that's right. That's I think that it's a very serious issue that all stakeholders ordinarily ought to pitch in terms of public enlightenment.
The other running story that I like to draw attention to is the issue surrounding the attempts to retrieve the 2.1 billion money for arms deal. There are different perspectives. From the National Assembly, the Senate Minority Caucus of the PDP has called that within 48 hours, Chief Odisametu should be either charged to court or he should be granted administrative bail. And they allege that there's discrimination. However, the chairman of EFCC has said that Jafar Issa, that is being used as a basis for discrimination, actually was held for 4 days, and it was after he returned 100 million and signed undertaking that he was allowed to go and fetch for the balance of 70 million. Meanwhile, the Telegram.
At this point, we must go.
Okay, I just trying to give.
I'm sure there must be more details on the Lassa fever.
On Lassa fever and any other headlines that were also read out in the papers this morning. Bayo Atoyebi, thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
Good morning, Nigeria. It's Good Morning, Nigeria. We're taking a short break now. When we return, it will be time for our principal item for discussion this morning.
You get three kinds of moms. The paranoid mom.
It's hot and it's dirty.
The cautious mom. And the Dettol mom. Only a Dettol mom knows that ordinary soaps aren't enough. She only trusts Dettol to protect her family from up to 100 illness-causing germs, which is why you can worry less and love more. Don't just be any mom. Be a Dettol mom. Dettol. Be 100% sure.
Introducing the new Dettol 55-gram soap. With the same germ protection and quality at a more affordable price. Buy the new Dettol 55-gram soap for 80 naira only. Keep your family protected from germs.
We have always lived together as brothers and sisters. Though we speak different languages and celebrate different cultures, we were still one Nigeria. There was no bombing, there was no kidnapping, and our children were not cultists. Now, we suspect one another as there are spreads of cultism, bombing, and kidnapping. How long shall this go on? Terrorism is alien. Kidnapping is criminal. Cultism is barbaric. Nigeria is a blessed country. Support the Nigeria Police and the fight against terrorism, kidnapping, and cultism. Always inform the police of any incident around you. Say something when you suspect something.
Remember, we all have a stake in building a crime-free Nigeria of our dream.
This message is from the Nigeria Police Force.
Can you believe it, guys? All this top-notch furniture, it's made in Nigeria! I said, made in Nigeria! How do I look, guys?
Made in Nigeria.
Made in Nigeria.
Come to Made in Nigeria TV Expo and Exhibition 2016, where Nigerian manufacturers and producers meet buyers, and also showcase your products to over 150 million Nigerians and the global audience online. So many other products are produced here on a daily basis. Booking and hotel reservation, call 080-6422-1412 and 070-3768-1520. Call now, guys!
You're watching Good Morning Nigeria, showing on Africa's largest television network, the NTA. Now time to take a look at the prompt for our conversation this morning. Research and development are considered the engine room of any agriculturally developed economy. How effective and efficient are research institutions in the development of the Nigerian agricultural sector? Omotola Omojola tries to provide answers.
According to the president of the African Development Bank, Nigeria's Dr. Akinwumi Adesina, a nation that cannot feed itself is not a free country, adding that there can be no democracy without, first, a democracy of the stomach. That statement captures the importance of agriculture to any people, food at the center of the provision of livelihood.
There is no way and no excuse for Nigeria to spend something in the neighborhood of $20 billion a year importing food.
That was the Minister of Agriculture, Dr. Aldo Ogbe, speaking to members of the House Committee on Agricultural Production Services on the state of the Nigerian agricultural sector. It is obviously an expression of worry and the urgent need to change the trend of events if the sector will indeed regain its days of glory. Nigeria before the oil boom of the 70s was a largely agrarian nation that was self-sufficient in food production and prospering on internal and external sales of agricultural produce. The success of the sector in the 70s and the 80s are traceable to well-articulated policies that is as a result of research and the institutionalization of agriculture.
It is agricultural research that will give you the kind of crop yields, the kind of yields you want to get from agriculture. You have to come with the kind of seedlings you have, the kind of crops you have, the quality of animal breeds you have. All of these come from consistent and effective research and development.
Nigeria has a range of agricultural institutions established with specific focus to provide interventions at different points for the development of the sector. Maximizing their potential appear to be a challenge.
There is a need for adequate funding as well as motivation of research officers with a view to retaining them.
Fund the institute appropriately, moderate the political way to use it, and we must bring a proper coordination for what they do, and we must introduce innovation.
With the growing challenge of climate change, which is affecting the natural balance of the world, research is imperative for sustainable agricultural development that will give room for food sufficiency in order to produce alternatives to the natural sources of food cultivation. Successes have been recorded in some countries of the world who pay attention to research and development in their agricultural sectors.
The last time I was in Brazil, the minister there told me that they had 190 million cows when Brazil's population was 140 million.
One would then wonder why agricultural research in Nigeria seems not to enjoy the pride of place it deserves.
Right now, the House of Representatives, or the Committee on Agriculture, is considering, and it has gone an advanced stage, a bill for the purpose of establishing the National Agricultural Fund that will fund research institute, our various researches in the agricultural sector.
It is hoped that plans will meet action and implementation to create sustainability in the sector.
All right, thank you very much there, Motola, for that background report, elaborate background report. Blessing, we have a number of guests in and outside the studios this morning to discuss this, in Abuja and, of course, outside Abuja. So, kick off.
All right, I'll start off with the guests in the Abuja studio. We have Professor Ayola Gbolagade, who is the founder and president Farm and Infrastructure Foundation Nigeria. It's our pleasure to welcome you to the program.
Good morning, thanks.
And from our Ibadan Network Center, we have sitting there already, Dr. Kenton Dashell. He's a Deputy Director, General Partnership and Capacity Development with International Institute of Tropical Agriculture, IITA. Mr. Dashell, would like to welcome you to the program.
Thank you very much. Good morning.
Okay, and then, of course, back to the Abuja studios. We also have with us Professor Babagana Abagambo, Head of Department Crop Production at the University of Maiduguri. Professor Abagambo, it's our delight to have you on Good Morning Nigeria.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Nigeria.
Okay, and then we also have with us in the Abuja studios the president of the All Farmers Association of Nigeria. He's also an architect, by the way, Malam Kabir Ibrahim. It's our delight to have you on Good Morning Nigeria.
Good morning. Good morning, Nigerians. Thank you very much.
All right. Gentlemen, unfortunately, Blessing, we don't have Lydia amongst our guests this morning. So,
yes.
Gentlemen, let's...
No, I'll stand there for that.
Yeah, no. All right. Let's begin with Professor Gbolagade before we go over to Ibadan. What we tried to encapsulate the essence of research in agriculture, you know, with dealing with seedlings, dealing with pests and diseases, dealing with varieties and so on and so forth. But what exactly are we looking at when we are seeking to situate the significance of agricultural research in food security?
Thank you very much. The importance of research cannot be overemphasized and cannot be downplayed. There are two major issues concerning agricultural progress of any country. One is technology, and the other is public policy. Agricultural research is the sole source of technology creation. And by research, we don't mean organized research only. We mean research that everybody conducts, apart from those who have been formally trained in an organized manner within certain institutional settings to conduct research. Almost everybody who engages in logical reasoning is undergoing research at any point in time. Be that as it may be, the real essence of research is to generate technology and to inform public policy and to manage the knowledge system that emerge from the two. So research is a continuum of activities that helps society to innovate from time to time, because progress is underlined by continuous innovation. So agricultural research in Nigeria dates back to the pre-colonial times because of that. Indeed, the starting point of agricultural development was research, right from 1893, when the British colonialists established the first botanical garden at Ebutemeta in Lagos. What they were doing was experimental research to try new varieties, to try new products that could be adapted from metropolitan Britain into our Nigerian environment, and so on. And they graduated into establishing institutions, organized institutions for that matter, starting from the set of laboratories to formal research institutes, and so on and so forth. So Nigerian agricultural research has taken root a long time ago, and it represents the backbone to agricultural development, without which development cannot take place in any meaningful sense.
Well, Professor Bolagade, thank you very much. Let's take Professor Abba Gambo, of course, who's head of the Department of Crop Science. The last statement made by Professor Bolagade says, it's the agricultural research, or research is the backbone of our agricultural development. But some observers query whether indeed this is a positive assertion to make, considering the challenges that we face with food production, preservation, and all issues pertaining again to sufficiency in our staple food crops, as well as food security.
Thank you, Kingsley. The problem we're having is the word research is not being understood the way it's supposed to be. Research, in very simple terms, means a creative work undertaken on a systematic basis to increase knowledge. That's the beginning and the end of it. So any work that is done, creative, very important, then it must be done on a systematic basis. And then at the end of the day, what do you expect? A new a kind of increment to knowledge that was not existing before. Like Prof actually said, when you're talking in theoretical terms, we said actual research started in 1907 at Moore Plantation by the British colonial masters. That's about 119 years ago. But then over the time, so many things have happened. And even prior to that, I must let our viewers know that farmers were actually conducting some kind of research in courts on their farms. When you're going through the farm, maybe it's a maize farm, you found out that a particular maize stand is giving bigger cups, maybe four cups instead of the normal two, and then obi your millet head, this one is stronger, is bigger. So farmers, they observe and then they select such varieties, they collect them, and then they keep them for seed for next year. So this is a kind of research, even though it's not the conventional research. But then over the time, the research became full-blown. Today we are talking about 15 agricultural research institutes under the purview of the Agricultural Research Council. We have 3 federal universities of agriculture, all into direct agricultural research. We have 11 federal colleges of agriculture, also all into direct agricultural research. But then your question is, how far? If you ask me, I think we still have a long way to go. Our research has not really brought out what we actually expect.
Okay. Thank you very much, Professor Abba Gambol. Now, our question is going over to our guest in Ibadan. Of course, that's Dr. Kenton Dasho, Deputy Director General, IITA. Now, let's take a look at, the two gentlemen that have spoken have touched on what research should be. Let's take a look at what evidence-based agriculture and research is doing in a country like Nigeria. What is your experience so far, and how do we begin to move based on what the other gentlemen have spoken about?
Thank you very much. Evidence-based research, of course, is using science to move forward. Maybe I just give a couple examples. The research needs to be focused very well on the real needs of the farmers in this case. Just take an example like maize in Nigeria, such an important crop. Some years back, there was a devastating disease called maize streak virus that was really lowering the yields in a big way all across the country. And researchers at IITA, in collaboration with several national scientists in universities and the research institutes, dedicated a lot of work to this. And they had to get germplasm from all over the world, bring it to Nigeria, test it, and after some years, we had a very good resistance to this disease. And just let me give one more example, just to tell you, just to inform our audience how some of these things work. We also had a disease, a problem on cassava called cassava mealybug that was drastically reducing the yields of cassava across the country and across the continent. And this was a new organism that came and was destroying the crop. We found out that this organism had come from Latin America. And so scientists went to Latin America and discovered a tiny wasp, a tiny insect, that the only thing that insect does is destroy this mealybug. And so again, scientists working together as a team from IITA and the National Research Institutes brought this new insect into Nigeria, and within a short time, a few years, this problem called cassava mealybug was no longer a problem in Nigeria and all across Africa. So this is how we work internationally to solve problems here in Nigeria.
Very much for your contribution. I will come back to you in the course of this conversation. You touched on one aspect, which is research into diseases of crops, of course, on soil as well, that we'll be talking about. But earlier we introduced architect Kabir Ibrahim, who is the president of the Farmers Association of Nigeria. Professor Abba Gambol, this says something. Yes, we have a plenitude of research institutes, universities and colleges, you know, offering agriculture where research is supposed to be going on, but there would appear to be a disconnect between the output of these institutes as well as the end users. As a farmer and as, of course, representative of farmers in the country, what has been your experience in benefiting from research outcomes?
Thank you very much. The essence of research to the farmer is the evolution of good seeds, good technology, and to improve our production. We have, over the years, relied on results that we get from the institutes, from their research work, to plant certain crops. And the greatest benefit that we should derive from that is an improvement in our production or productivity. What we have seen now is a very gradual growth in that sector, but that can be better. It can be better, and that's why I think we are even embracing biotechnology. The
some people are claiming that GM is not good for us, for the human body and all that, but it will take us out of poverty. The subsistence farming that is prevalent in our food system is not good for Nigeria, and that's why there is an apathy, or people, young people, run away from agriculture, because the drudgery involved there is not worth what we get from it. So we will encourage more funding for the research institutes, more dedication from researchers, and better productivity for the farmers. So that's why we will every day embrace good research and the use of research findings.
Thank you, Kabir Ibrahim, President of Farmers Association of Nigeria. Let's take a look at some other examples that have been given. I've said in the 60s, of course, and in the 70s, issue of cocoa, of course, which is one of cash crops, then rubber and groundnut, among other cash crops, that used to be major non-oil foreign exchange for the country. At a point, it's as if something went wrong, because what people are actually asking, can these issues, of course, the decline in them being up there, be traced to lack of serious research and development? Or why were the research institute not able to halt the slide, at least that we find ourselves with today? Professor Ayola.
Thank you very much. Indeed, you are touching on the issue of research effectiveness. Research effectiveness depends on several factors, and we have lost ground on many of these factors over the years. In those days when the progress of agriculture in terms of the pyramids you mentioned was underlined by serious business in research, that was the trend. But immediately this declined, the effectiveness of research in terms of output, in terms of yield of crops, in terms of price of products, in terms of even quality of life of people, like issues in food security, and so also started to decline with research. And unless we pick that up again, we may not be able to resume that important trend. What are the factors? First and foremost is the factor of research funding. Research is a capital intensive venture. It's either a nation decides to do it or it does not desire to do it. You can't do it halfway with half measures. There must be good equipment to do research. There must be high quality staff to do good research. There must be working capital for running research experiments, conducting social science research, and so many other things. Therefore, nations that are serious about research allocate heavy amount of their public budget to research, and it shows, it reverberates up and up inside the output and outcomes of research activities and in the performance of the economy of those places. We are not doing well about research funding. We are not doing well about research staffing. We are not.
I'm just sorry, Professor Ayola. Funding is a major challenge in several aspects of our national life. But let's go back again to the stats. As Professor Abagambo indicated, 15 agricultural research institutes. Three universities dedicated solely to the study of agriculture, even though we hear these days that they are already admitting students for some other disciplines.
Mascom.
You know, colleges of agriculture and so on and so forth. All of it, is it that, are there too many so that if we were to collapse them, we'll have collapse and then streamline them, and then it would be a lot easier to fund them? Why have so many and then they are not as effective as they ought to be, minus funding?
You have not even mentioned the faculties of agriculture in the conventional universities,
that's right,
at state and federal level in this country. Added to them, it now becomes even a larger space. Yes. But my take is that it is not the number of these institutes that really matter. What matters is proper coordination of what they are doing. In the United States of America, you almost find a research based institute in a county. You cannot count them. You know, if you go to India,
India was numbering about 106 research institutes and so on. Because agriculture is so vast, research has to be specialized as it grows along commodity lines, which is why we have 15 research institutes in Nigeria. The ones focusing on cereals, the one focusing on root and tubers, the one on pests and diseases, and so on and so forth. That is in order. What we lack, apart from the funding arrangement, is proper coordination and role definition, division of labor among these set of institutions. Let me give you an example. For we have not settled some issues about which of these institutes perform basic research, which seeks knowledge for knowledge's sake, which among them goes ahead with applied research, which one does the adaptive research. All of them are important, and one fits into the other. Without good theoretical and basic research, you cannot talk of good applied research, and so on and so forth. Right. So it's not the number.
Okay.
It is the function.
Professor Ayola, just let's pause you in the meantime and go back again to Professor Abagambo. Professor Abagambo, there is a council that is ordinarily supposed to coordinate the research institute. And once you have a council, that will be, as it were, the supreme organ. What is missing in terms of proper and effective coordination of the research institutes? And then take along with this the point you made earlier about the ineffectiveness of research outcomes.
Thank you, Kingsley, once again. You see, the issue is research all over the world is supposed to be demand-driven. Blessing was talking about the 60s and 70s. By then, those people that were buying our groundnuts, those people that were buying the cocoa, they knew a particular variety and the way that thing should be taken to them. So it was a kind of demand. And the farmers were now working to make sure that that particular demand is satisfied. Unfortunately, in Nigeria today, all the research institutes, the kind of research that you have is what you call supply driven. So the demand is no longer there. The government is not asking the research institutes produce something. The private sector, even NASCO in Jos, that is doing conflicts, is supposed to have talked to the serious research institute. Tell them, this is the kind of mess we want for our complex. Please, can you help us add some more value to it? They are not doing it.
And why is that so, sir?
Because they feel that they can just go to the outside market and then get whatever they want. So everything is being imported. The bakers, the millers, NASCO, all the maize, they have the best variety of maize from outside. They import it. The best variety of wheat from outside, they import it.
Brewers.
But then if you can actually give, for example, Lecture Research Institute in Maiduguri, Borno State has the mandate for wheat in Nigeria. If you can actually give them the demand, produce so kind of wheat, and then we'll be able to take it up, it's going to solve the problem. Then talking about the coordination, you see, you have the Agricultural Research Council based here in Abuja. They have a council, they have a chairman, etc. Then all the 15 research institutes, each of the 15 research institutes has also a chairman and a council. So if you're to take at least maybe 30 council members for all the 15 research institutes, you're now talking about 450 people.
That's a parliament.
I'm telling you, that was the council of the Agricultural Research Institute. In Brazil, the EMPRAPA is the best research model in the world today. And what they have is, they have a single council, just one representative that is permanently stationed in the Ministry of Agriculture. Everything begins and ends with him, and then the information is just flowing. By the time you go to India, ICA, the Indian Corporation for Agricultural Research, is all over India, as vast and as populous as India is. They just have one ICA, and that ICA coordinates everything. By the time you go bring 200, 450 people, it's another House of Representatives. You understand? So in between, you find out that things will not move. And then let me quickly add, the main procedure of bringing a new variety is also cumbersome.
In the country?
In the country, it's very cumbersome. Let's just go through it. If, for example, I want to breed for a new cowpea variety that is resistant to some pest, I have to get a team. I write my proposal, I get a team as quickly as possible. The team must include even those that are not in agriculture, socioeconomic, home economics, the culinary aspect, etc.
Nutrition.
Nutrition. Now then, I have to work on it for about 2 years. After 2 years, I now have a variety, and then I have to do on-station research. That's within my research institute. Then after that, I have to take it out for multi-locational trials, different places, maybe two or three. Then after that, I now come back, and then I gauge everything. It becomes what you call a candidate. So that candidate is now submitted to the National Varietal Research Committee, and it's being headed by Professor Olufoju at Ahmad Bello University, Zaria. There is a subcommittee. So your candidate now comes to the subcommittee.
For election.
Not for election. For screening.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, exactly, for screening. So the candidate now comes. If it is a cereal, you come with at least 50 kg of the seed. If it is a vegetable, then you come with at least a sizable number that can plant up to half an acre.
In all of this, the process is lengthy.
We've not even started the process. So the technical subcommittee on varietal trial, which consists of all the agricultural institutes, faculties of agriculture, deans of agri, all of them will now come and sit. The National Seed Council, the Federal Ministry of Agriculture, Federal Ministry of Environment, Federal Ministry of Science and Technology, they will now sit down and then screen the variety. It takes about 2 days. Then after 2 days, if the variety is deemed viable, then it's now given a positive response, and then it goes to the next stage. If it is not deemed viable, from that, the candidate failed the screening. Mm. So it shall not go into the election.
They ask for it now.
So the candidate, that's it.
But what obtains in the other developed nation? Is it not the same process of actually taking it through?
It's the same process, but then this time around, with better equipment, you could actually make it shorter.
Short circuit the process.
Exactly. Better technology.
Okay, Professor Abagambo, thank you very much, you know, for the political analogy that you use in illustrating the challenges that are faced with seeking to get research outputs verified and approved. But Dr. Dashiell, of course, you made your initial remarks when you first spoke. What, in your opinion, are the impediments to, you know, the whole value chain of research, both demand, supply, and utilization of research outputs in Nigeria? IIT, of course, has been foremost over the years.
Well, I would say that I won't try to repeat the impediments that have been described by previous speakers, but there are some outstanding technologies ready for the farmers in Nigeria that will really significantly increase productivity for the farmers. And these are not available to the farmers at this time. What are the constraints? They are many. One of them is that the farmers don't get the information, the knowledge that they need to move forward and improve their production. So it's the communication of the results from the outstanding research that has been conducted. So I can just give you an example. We have outstanding methods to control weeds in cassava. And while I don't need to go into the details, I would guess that, you know, maybe 1% of the farmers in Nigeria know about these methods. And so the extension service, the ability of the private sector to deliver the inputs to the farmers at reasonable cost, and at a location very close to their farm. So one of the big problems we do have is those outstanding research results are not being delivered to the farmers as efficiently as they should be.
Okay, well, Dr. Snell, thank you very much for your remarks. Blessing.
Yes, let's take a look at the farmer in our midst. Of course, there's been so much talk about the disconnect between research focus by the research institutes and also the farmers. How do we begin to have the synergy in place based on what we're looking at, research development, and definitely issue of extension services, even as mentioned by Dr. Kensi Nibadun?
Thank you very much once again. The farmer definitely is at the receiving end of everything that has been mentioned here. But, you know, if you innovate extension work, the information would go down to the farmers a lot faster.
Mm.
And we have some innovation in extension that is in India today. It's called Digital Green. They, instead of, you know, using people to reach out to farmers, you digitally reach them. It is faster. In the viewing centers in all the villages and local governments in Nigeria, you can adapt this methodology, and the information would get to the farmers as quickly as possible. And the farmers would simply learn good practices and implement them, thereby, you know, taking themselves out of poverty. Mm-hmm. Instead, I mean, instead of waiting for extension workers and information to be disseminated to them. So I believe that in the coming days, with the interest that we are taking in agriculture, the farmers will be better off if some innovation is brought to the results and findings of innovation, reaching them at the right time.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, well, I'm just wondering, Malam Kabir Ibrahim, Professor Abba Gambo said that research will look at it from the demand side and from the supply side, but that the recent experience has been that research has been supply driven, as it were. Why are farmers not presenting problems or challenges to researchers to focus on specially and then give results back to the farmers?
Well, look, we are not making a lot of noise about it, but farmers are always talking with researchers. In fact, recently we had an outing in Zaria IAR. We had a meeting, all the farmers, in all the chairman of farmer of the AFAN, all farmers, all the chairman of AFAN in all the states of the Federation came together, and we sat down and interacted with researchers there, and we gave our complaints and all that. And they listened, and I think they are working on it. We are trying to make a good platform for even the policy. You know, just the other day, I was with Prof. Ayola, with the minister, talking about a platform for farmers and for agriculture and policy. So we are not oblivious of what is happening in the research institutes, and we are always telling the researchers our problems. And they are providing some solutions in some cases. But, you know, the Nigerian psyche is that even the indigenous people, the Nigerians, don't want or have apathy for what is produced in Nigeria. This is the problem. If anybody is importing corn from Brazil, for instance, the landing cost in Lagos is about $300 per ton. If you go to Dawano market in Kano, you would probably buy maize at something like $250 per ton, but people still want to buy from Brazil.
Okay, well, we'll come to that, you know, the Nigerian taste for imported items. And, you know, of course, you see bananas. Some people will be telling you here in Abuja and sometimes in Lagos as well that this banana is from Cameroon, you know, and you see this.
This is
very yellow. All right, but you can see on the screen there, we have our Twitter handle for you to send in your reactions and comments to the discussion. We have a number of reactions already. The Twitter handle, once again, is at NTAGMN. We'll take a few of those tweets now, and then we'll continue the conversation. Listen.
All right, we have one from Safine Height at Gmail. It said, if we are serious, let's invest more on Agric. How much did we capture as per Agric in the present budget? Are we serious? That's his question. Well, you or she, no. Ofondo Chukwebuka says, the problem is not in doing research, but what happens after the research?
Okay, well, that's the similar question being posed by Sonny Michael Omakoji. He says, what are the results of agricultural research institutes over the years? I sent a tweet from Lokoja, another one from Bright Irene. For agriculture fully tackled in Nigeria, federal and state governments need to develop infrastructure in rural areas, as that motivates people. These are some of the tweets that we have received. Others, of course, we'll take in the course of the conversation. Professor Ayola, let's again deal with the question of the demand side
for research. Now, we're not just talking about the problem. See, one of the challenges that we are facing today, 41 persons have died already from Lassa fever. And one of the commonest causes, as has also been indicated, is how some harvested crops, you know, are dried, are sun-dried, and they're left in the open. You find them off even in urban centers. You go around some locations in Abuja, you see them drying seeds and
on the highways,
you know, and so on and so forth. So, what has been the challenge, you know, in trying to encourage farmers, you know, to come to the research institute so we get a demand side rather than just having mostly supply-driven research?
Thank you. In conducting a balanced market analysis for research, because research itself and its products has its own demand and supply sides of the market, as we have learned, two critical factors are tied to the performance of that market from the demand side. One is the role of extension that has been seriously illuminated. But one aspect of it that we have not mentioned is the fact that the variety of people we have in farming in Nigeria today is different from in other advanced countries. The AFAM president, when he used the word we as farmers, I wanted to assist him to disaggregate what that we looks like.
That's right.
Averagely, in Nigeria, we have a population of farmers that are one, small scale in nature, two, cash strapped, very poor, mostly scattered all over the place, living in rural places,
subsistent,
and largely inarticulate as such, to the extent that they may not even be able to properly capture what their demand should be,
that's right,
when a research product confronts them. And that is the role of extension, to be able to induce that demand directly by way of adoption and offtake. Because of the nature, for the large scale farmers, urban based farmers, industrial farmers, we don't need agricultural extension. They can seek their products and inputs on their own because they have an innate capacity to evaluate their needs. But the small scale farmer does not. And that is why the answer to the question of demand side lies heavily on inducing the farm population of Nigeria to generate this demand through agricultural extension.
Okay,
that is one. I'm sorry. The second is commercialization of research results. It's also tied to the issue of demand side. The many factors that impede commercialization also restrict that demand growth. And unless we do something in that area in terms of power to commercial, to demand for commercialization to take place, in terms of money, income of people, and so on. All these are tied together to determine the status of agricultural product demand in Nigeria.
Okay, there's a quick tweet here, which we're asking, but we'd like to say a big thank you for joining our conversation this morning, because we must bring in another guest at this point. I appreciate your contribution, Professor Balagade Ayola. But the tweet, of course, saying where law and banking actually are run in Agricultural Research Institute. What do we expect? That's food for thought for us. This is Good Morning Nigeria. We'll take a break at this junction to bring some messages, and it will be time to continue discussion on the program this morning.
Nigerians, our fearless officers and men of the Nigerian military are winning the war against Boko Haram. Today, all occupied territories have been recovered and Boko Haram has been degraded. Our affected brothers and sisters are getting their lives back. However, they are now after you and me. In our mosques, churches, schools, motor parks, markets, entertainment centers, and public gatherings. Be vigilant. Be security conscious. Report suspicious persons, objects, and movements to the police and other security agencies. The security of our nation is a duty for you and me. Nigeria, unite against terrorism.
This message is brought to you by the Federal Ministry of Information and Culture.
Helen!
Would you like some water? It's cold, especially for you.
Which era are you living in? We have a fridge.
When everything else in your house is from the present, then why are your toilet cleaning methods from the past? Harpic, all in one for you. Compared to other toilet cleaners, Harpic removes top stains, kills all germs, and removes bad odors. For a shining clean and fresh toilet.
Wow!
You should also take the Harpic
all in one challenge.
Messages on our bottles and cans, so now you can share a Coke and a feeling with family and friends.
All right, it's good morning, Nigeria. We're live on the network service of the Nigerian Television Authority. Today, of course, you can see from the caption on the screen, we're discussing agricultural research and, of course, the impact on food production as well as our food security in the country. We have a guest at Ibadan. He's been speaking to us. We have just signed off Professor Ayola, but we still have with us the president of All Farmers Association of Nigeria. That's an architect as well, architect Kabir Ibrahim, and Professor Abba Gambo is head of crop production at the University of Maiduguri. Now we've been joined by another guest. He's Senator Aliu Sabi Abdullahi. Senator Abdullahi is a veterinary doctor. Senator Abdullahi, sir, I'd like to have you on Good Morning Nigeria.
Good morning.
Okay, now let's just go straight to the vet aspect of research. There's a very well-known institute at VOM, somewhere near Jos. That's the Veterinary Research Institute near Jos. But this is what we see. And I remember, you know, we ran a story many years ago about the beef that we find in our marketplaces, that some of them are tuberculoid. And when you see the cattle that are being headed, you know, through the streets or grazing along the highways or whatever, yes, they look lean, they look gaunt, they look malnourished, and even not diseased outright. The same thing with perhaps, you know, some other livestock that we get. What is it that has been the disconnect between the work of researchers and those who are pastoralists?
All right. Good morning, Nigerians. Thank you very much. The first thing I would like to say first before going straight into your question is that earlier on, Professor Ayola and Professor Abba Gambo have alluded to the fact that research should be demand-driven. But what is the origin or the beginning of that demand? I think let me point out here that the origin of that demand should be the national development goal. Because whatever you do in research, you should be seen to be addressing your national development goal. Yeah. And in agriculture, earlier on Professor Ayola took that point, but I think he left it just hanging there. Now, what are the policies or the development goals that this country pursues? The first is food security, because you must be able to feed your own, you know, citizens. Then the next is you are looking at, can you make some money out of it? Can you get foreign exchange out of it, which means you want to export certain things? And that's why you were talking about the early 60s, 70s, when we have the pyramids and all the like. Mm. Now, the other one is industrialization. You want to have products that you feed as raw materials into your industries. Now, if you just take these three alone, you will come to realize that what you have alluded to earlier, or what you have described earlier, is actually, you know, the missing gap. Because for us in research, If the idea is to address food security, the government should have a national program, identify the commodities, okay? Now, if you look at what is happening, we are importing rice, for example. Rice falls within the ambit of what you should pursue as a national security policy. But what has been happening? If you look at the situation right now, we import a lot, isn't it? We know the figures runs into billions. Now, what is happening at the research institute? I will tell you, for example, National Root Crop, National Cereals Research Institute, Badegi, has been without the chief executive for the past 8 years. What you've been having is acting. That shows that at the policy level, those at the helm of affairs have not given enough attention to what should be happening there. Now, back to the issue of the livestock you have mentioned. NVRI is saddled with the responsibility of conducting research into diseases of livestock, all livestock. They've been doing their best. You know the diseases of Rinderpest? Of course, they've been able to produce, the Rinderpest vaccine, and today Nigeria is Rinderpest free. Now, if you look at other disease conditions, they have been doing their best as far as that is concerned. But the situation is such that still, because of the disconnect between addressing research that is focusing on these national development goals, attention is not being given to them. So what you see is they are doing their best, but that disconnect in terms of making sure that they are conducting research that is actually feeding into our national development policy is lacking. Now, the other aspect is that they have series of vaccines they've developed for poultry, but today we still import these vaccines because some people are using that to also do round tripping that we know.
Well, distinguished Senator, you just elaborated on the scope of our conversation this morning. In other words, the policy framework that ordinarily should drive research, both the demand and the supply side that Professor Abba Gambo referred to earlier. Professor Abba Gambo, that's why this question is coming to you now. One aspect that he has touched on, look at the loop. Let's try to establish the loop. If we have an industrial policy that says, look, we ought to be able to produce raw materials for our industrial needs, we are sure that manufacturers who are perennially crying over forex allocation for raw material importation probably will cry less. Do you have industry persons approaching you in crop production to say this is X, Y, Z that we need? And if not, are you also reaching out to say, look, this is what we have, and you market what you've got, Professor Abba Gambo?
Kingsley, the scenario outside is much more than what you think. Coincidentally, I'm the agri-consultant to the Nigerian Governors Forum for the last 6 years. At the Nigerian Governors Forum, we did a peer review of all the 36 states recently. And in all the 36 states, there is no single state-owned agricultural research center, none in the whole country. That is one. Then the second issue is, Blessing was talking about drying cassava, etc., on the road. We moved around the 36 states. We did not find a single agro-processing plant that is governmental in any of the 36 states. So research are being done, whether demand or supplied. But the issue is, the man that is supposed to utilize the research, there is a disconnect between. Every variety is supposed to be called what you call a stable variety. When I was giving you the procedure, then it becomes a breeder. From a breeder seed, it becomes a foundation seed. Then finally, it becomes a grower seed, and then you release it to the farmers. So many varieties are being released. The meeting is being done twice a year. Every 6 months, that committee sits. And then every 6 months, they release about 15, 16 varieties. But the farmers are not picking them up. Sometimes ago, there was a particular research institute that came with the mini sets of yam. You know, the small yam, you must have seen it. Exactly. So when they released it to the farmers' wives refused taking it because the poundability was very low. You understand? So they said, if you want pounded yam, good pounded yam, don't buy that tiny, tiny thing. So you better buy the original one we know. And at the Lecture Research Institute also, there was a particular variety of millet that was to tackle quail bats. So they bred it in such a way that it has some spikes on the millet heads. So when the bats come, instead of them touching the seed, the spike will now prick them.
It acts as a scarecrow.
Exactly. Much more, because it's just inbuilt. And they are very sharp. So when you now bring it to the house, the woman said, by the time they are processing it, all their hands will be bloated. They said, you want us to give you Brabusco today, 2-0 today, and then you are making our hands bloody. Please don't bring that variety again. So the issue of
what happens at the beginning must take into cognizance the needs of the farmers, the needs of the community. All the research institutes are in various zones, and they are supposed to be in touch with the local community. Ask them, what exactly do you need today? What do you want us to do for you? But like the senator said, this has to come from, it has to be a kind of policy, governmental.
Oh, okay.
Okay, well, exactly. Okay, coming back to distinguished senator, before we go take the trip to Ibadan, of course, we still have our guest there. Of course, Senator, you're actually involved in a project on agricultural reform, and you're well traveled. You've seen examples in Brazil, China, which these are some of the developed economies we're talking about today. Share some of the experience with us. What are they doing differently? And that they've been able to hold on to what they've done in terms of research and development that we are not still applying.
Yeah, thank you very much. Let me make this point clear, that if you have a clear national policy and goals, what you need to do is you have to ask yourself, who are those who are going to bring this thing home to you? Now, in the case of agriculture, what we have seen is that for agricultural research, the world over, research is the engine of growth of the agricultural sector. It's the engine of growth. And that has been proven so many times. Because if you invest, for example, if you invest $1 in agricultural research, you are bound to get $10 to $20 as return. And this has been proven across many studies in many climates. Now, what we have seen is that the case of research in Nigeria, first, the coordination is weak.
We've talked about it.
And that is the point you was making earlier. Yeah. So what we have seen is that for us to make progress, a country like Brazil has been spending $1 billion over the past 10 years consistently. Because of that, they were able to focus on their research institute where they have ISO certified laboratories, so that anything that that laboratory is telling you is coming out with as a result, you have no doubt that this thing is actually accurate. Mm. Now, they also have highly trained researchers at PhD level. They have one of the highest level of PhD trainees, where they send them to various countries of the world. And you know, the moment you send a PhD trainee to any country, the technology available there is what he's able to use. When he comes back home, he's able to adapt. Now, in our own case, what we have seen over the past years is that our research funding has even dipped, even though it's one of the highest in our zone. But it has dipped. And the research institutes today, they don't have laboratories. Wow. Their research scientists right now are aging. We have one of the highest aging research scientists in Africa, because we have those who are 50 above. In fact,
they are old. 50 above is old.
They are almost going. They are almost going. Now, let me tell you, earlier you took me up on the issue of livestock.
Yes.
Will you believe that the last time somebody was appointed in NAPRI, where they carry out research on forage and livestock feed, was about 15 years ago. The last person who was appointed as a staff to work in that particular research program became a professor without anybody below him.
Okay,
what I'm trying to say here is that it is not possible for a country to want to eat its cake and have it at the same time.
We don't have the cake in the meantime.
It's just a function of how you apply the cake.
Where is the cake? I mean, we're talking about we have to bake the cake. I mean, we also have to grow the wheat.
So I'm sorry, one point before I hang it. The aspect of extension, which I think Dr. Dashen was talking about earlier, what we saw is that, you see, in India, they have one of the best extension service. But what they do is, we have 774 local government, for example. What is the extension activity in each of these local governments? We come to realize that it's almost non-existent.
That's a pertinent question. And I think, I hope Professor Abba Gambo doesn't lose his consultancy with the Governors Forum. We're going to come back to that to see what exactly is wrong with states and local governments. I mean, every time they're all gathering in Abuja trying to share money from oil, and in the meantime, they are not focused on agriculture. We'll come back to that and then deal with extension services utilizing in local governments as well as state governments. Now, back to our Ibadan Network Center, Dr. Kentin Dashel. Dr. Kentin Dashel, you've listened to the comments I've been mean, Nigerians have spoken more about the problems of research in this country. What's your take on the comments made by the other guests? And in particular, I would like you to also respond to this. Do we also focus, from your experience, on research into soil samples? Because I know, of course, if you are traveling to a place like the United States, they will ask you whether you are carrying any soil samples, and those things are prohibited. Do we, you know, focus on soil research?
Yeah, specifically, the research on soils is extremely important. It is the foundation of all agriculture production. When our farmers know how to manage their soil well, we can have sustainable production for, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years, and of course that's what we need to have. But the situation in the country right now is, it could be improved a lot, because even though we've had substantial improvements with fertilizer availability, it is still not accessible as it should be. And fertilizer is really the key for maintaining the productivity of soils, in addition to some other aspects. I was very, I agree 100% with the comments from all my colleagues that have been speaking earlier this morning. And one of the also very important aspects about agriculture research is to find ways that will encourage the creation of jobs. We know this is a very important aspect in the country now, because so many of our youth are unemployed. And what we have discovered in our work at IITA with youth, we have been working with those youth that have just finished their National Youth Service Corps. So here we have youths that are not especially in agriculture. They might have been accounting or many other things, computer science, etc., graduates. And what we have found is, working with this group, they are very, very much adaptable to becoming very productive in agriculture. And the key here is changing the mindset of the youth, because the vast majority of youth actually believe that agriculture would be the last thing that they'd ever want to get into, because their vision of agriculture is the small-scale farmer, the way their grandfathers and grandmothers or their fathers and mothers have been doing agriculture. But the fact is that when we can encourage youth and give them the skills and the resources they need to get started, agriculture becomes a highly profitable and honorable profession. And I know that the federal government and some of the state governments have very aggressive programs to move youth into agriculture, and I think the research institutes need to get behind these programs and support them.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kenton Dashiell, Deputy Director General, Partnership and Capacity Development with the International Institute of Tropical Agriculture, IITA. Thank you very much for participating in the program today. Some tweets actually came in, actually making sure that people really are interested in the business of agric this morning. We'll quickly take a look at some of them. Douglas Orafa says, my generation was taught that a thesis work was a fulfillment of for graduating only. So we research only to get a certificate.
Well, we have another tweet here from Abubakar Ibrahim. Abubakar Ibrahim says, the government is doing its best to boost agriculture, but the farmers are ignorant of accepting innovation. And also from Sifine Hatch, she says, at Umudike, we fund our research, hoping to have a refund. But of course, this is not happening.
All right, Senator, what I can say to you on the allocation of research institute is the miss... this is
sorry, trustworthy. I think that what he's saying there is that Senator. So, what can you say with regards to 16 budget? Is it really missing? That's the question here. Okay.
Also, Angel Saint says, when government takes over completely, there will be a smooth connect between researchers and the farmers.
Dan Musa writes, government should engage public servants in serious agriculture by disengaging some of them, paying them off to start farming. Mm-hmm. All right, those are some of the tweets that we have received. We come back again now to the substance of our conversation this morning. Professor Abba Gambo, one more time before we come back to the president of the All Farmers Association of Nigeria. Why is it that state governments have been slow to respond to, you know, the obvious demands that our agricultural sector requires, whether in terms of research, applying research, extension services, connecting with farmers, big farmers, small farmers?
The truth is you have governors that were not ready to be governors. Really. When we did the peer review, the people in the Nigerian Governors Forum will tell you, we visited the 36 states. I think it was only in 3 states that we found a real agricultural policy documented. All the other states do not have, even as I'm talking to you now. But now, honestly, the NGF, with due respect to them, they have woken up. Think of the rice issue. I was the one that was mandated to write the consent letter for rice. The present NGF chairman, Abdulaziz Yari, and of course the governor of Kebbi State, they were on my neck. They made sure that the rice consent was there. I briefed them. We went to the vice president, and they insisted there should be a policy declaration at that meeting that by 2017, the government of Nigeria is going to ban the importation of rice. And that is a big plus to the Nigerian Governors Forum. For the first time, they said we have to do it, and I think they are on course. Now to the other states. Most of the governors, when you take them on agriculture, most especially the ones that have gone, when we're talking to them, you advise them, mop up the youths on the street. The easiest way is through agriculture. You understand? And in some cases, agricultural productivity can be seen in just 21 days. Get a piece of land, give him amaranthus, let him water. At exactly 21 days, the amaranthus are ready for the market. The boy is getting some money. So you can actually use agriculture to mop up all the youths. When we're telling them venture into agricultural development, most of them were talking about, I want to build an airport. Most of them, especially in the north, they have built the airport, and most of the airports, I saw it in the dailies, is it 2 or 3 days ago, they are idle, they are just lying fallow, etc.
And the youths are also idle and fallow.
Of course,
ready to be used by politicians.
Definitely, definitely.
Well, that's terrible. But Senator Abdullahi, just again to piggyback on your experience in China, and India and elsewhere. I mean, China is a vast country. The population is also humongous. How is China? I mean, of course, there are also small holdings in China, yeah. And they also don't have big holdings. How has China, what experience has China got to teach us with regard to what we can do with respect to our own farming populations?
Yeah, thank you very much. What they do here is, first, like we earlier noted, if a technology is being developed, it's being developed for a particular use by farmers. Now, their research institute is also very extensive. So what they do here is they have what they call spin-off companies. If you develop a technology, you know the risk in bringing in money on something you are not sure whether it will work. So the Chinese government has a program through which they do what they call spin-off companies, so that they commercialize these technologies, and then that person who actually developed the research technology can actually be recruited even by the spin-off company, side by side with the research institute. So as they are using it, refinement is continuous, and they are able to get this technology being used by a large number of people to make money. And because of that, what we have realized is that when it comes to commercialization of research technology, China has one of the best. And that is why they are able to go all the way through all their own, you know, regions to make sure that the product of research is available to those who should use it. Now, because they have small scale, what they do is they standardize. There is standardization such that farm A, even though it's 1 hectare, and all similar farms are having the same extension service, the same inputs,
that's
provision, and because of that, the output becomes uniform. And when you aggregate and bulk, if you are an industry, you are able to have, you know, this economy of scale. Now, in our own case here, for example, let me take rice.
we have over 52 varieties of rice. If you go all over this country, different farmers are planting different varieties of rice. What is the challenge? The challenge here is that when I come to buy from different sources,
you find different sizes of grains.
Different sizes of grain. If I come to boil, the boiling temperature is different. Some are boiled, properly boiled, some are not properly boiled. The end result is poor product. So that is why we are saying there is no proper planning. The research system is not being empowered to do what they need to do, as we have seen in Brazil and in India. And I think government is in the process of reforming that now.
Well, we have to, we'll look for the evidence of that reform. Senator, but listen, I think, yeah, just to go back to the president of the All Farmers Association, you had a tweet.
Yes, we have a tweet. It says, ring him. Of course, I'm a small-scale farmer, but no any input from government to help me. This year, I cease to plant wheat because I lost a lot last year. So, in addition to the question that you're going to...
In addition to that request by that tweet from that Twitter, I would like you to respond to a point that Senator Abdullahi made in terms of the policy framework. Say, look, how does agriculture cater for our industrial needs? We asked the question earlier. Do you find manufacturers or are Nigerian farmers patronized significantly for their raw materials? Because every time we keep hearing that forex demand for raw materials, forex demand.
The patronage is abysmal. But recently, there is something, you know, if you look at the wheat rice and wheat program that was launched in Kebbi, some millers were put together and some growers were brought, and the growers would grow rice that will be bought by the millers. Yeah. That synergy is very good for the farmer, because the farmer will have market for whatever the farmer produces. But aside from that, hitherto the tendency was for people for there to be apathy. In Jigawa State, for instance, during 2014, we had 176,000 farmers, rice farmers, who produced paddy, and the paddy was not more than 3,500 per bag of 80 kg. So, and a number of them simply could not go to the farm the following year because they had no patronage. Same thing with wheat in Zamfara and in Zamfara State. It was even going bad because the millers were not buying. So that is true, you know, but I believe this administration is poised to change that. Two, the input from government, probably this farmer was referring to GES. There was no GES in 2015. But for me, you know, and for majority of our farmers, GES connotes as it was run, subsistence farming. The concept of 2 bags of fertilizer and 12.5 kg of seed was not enough. Mm-hmm. Was going to keep you, at that level, subsistence level, therefore poverty. If there is some modification in GES, it could help the farmers and it would boost our production.
Okay, we need all the help that we can get, definitely, to actually make agriculture that same position we want it to be. Architect Kabir Ibrahim, President All Farmers Association of Nigeria, thank you so much for joining our conversation this morning. Also, we'd like to thank Professor Balagana Abagambo, Head of Department Crop Science, University of Maiduguri. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, blessing. It's a pleasure being
here. Last person, the list, Senator Ali Usabi Abdullahi, Chairman, Senate Committee on Media and Publicity, and also a veterinary doctor. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, my pleasure.
This is Good Morning Nigeria. It's now time for our companion segment.
We're taking sports and two items in our sports package this morning. Soccer, that's the Super Eagles, that home-based Super Eagles, who are set to leave Pretoria for Kigali, that's the capital of Rwanda, for the 2016 African Nations Championship. Plus, matters arising from injuries ahead of this year's Australian Open.
Coming off 1-0 friendly defeat of Cote d'Ivoire on Monday, Super Eagles coach Sandor Lisse's confidence of his side's chances of making history at the African Nations Championship, which begins in Rwanda this weekend. Though the tactician is spread to 12th time as he leads Nigeria in search of a fourth CHAN title in Kigali with a Group C elder against former champions Tunisia. The home-based national team have set up a training camp in Pretoria, South Africa, ahead of the tournament, and have been involved in two turn-up games, playing 1-1 draw in their first friendly and winning 1-0 on Monday's second friendly game against Ivory Coast. Nigeria first featured in the third edition of the CHAN event in 2014 and ended the campaign in third place. The Super Eagles B played a build-up matches in their Pretoria camp to fine-tune their preparation for the championship that begins this weekend in Kigali. Nigeria's home-based Super Eagles will play Niger Republic in their Group C force clash encounter on January 18 to begin their campaign at the championship. And straight to tennis, British number 2 Agnes Berdini was forced to retire owing to injury in his opening match at the ASB Classic. The 26-year-old world number 49 took the fourth set 7-6 against American Sam Querrey, having saved 4 break points. The second set also went to a tie break, which Sam won 7-6, but then Berdini withdrew when trailing 2-1 in the third. Still on tennis, Britain's Andy Murray wants to win a record-fifth Aegon Championship title at Queen's Club this summer. The 28-year-old world number 2 confirmed on Tuesday he will defend the title he won for a fourth time last year with victory over Kelvin Anderson. Murray, champion in 2009, 2011, 2013 and 2015, made his debut at Queen's in 2005 and used the club's clay court to prepare for Great Britain's Davis Cup final victory over Belgium in November.
From sports now to the foreign scene, 10 people are said to be killed in an explosion at central Istanbul, and the Supreme Court of the Philippines declares a security deal with the United States to be constitutionally, part of the constitution. Patricia Esamiluba has more on this and other details from the foreign scene.
Thanks and welcome. Let's start on the foreign news with report from Turkey saying 10 people have been killed in an explosion.